From its discovery around Jupiter to its composition and what mysteries it may hold and more, join us as we explore Ganymede, Jupiter's oceanic moon. Number 8. The finding and naming of Ganymede. At present, Jupiter has 79 moons, some of which have only been discovered recently. But in regards to Ganymede, it may have an origin that is far beyond the histories of the other moons. Chinese astronomical records report that in 365 BC, Gonda detected what might have been a moon of Jupiter, probably Ganymede, with the naked eye. However, Gonda reported the color of the companion as reddish, which is puzzling since the moons are too faint for their color to be perceived with the naked eye. Shen and Gan together made fairly accurate observations of the five major planets. On January 7, 1610, Galileo Galilei observed what he thought were three stars near Jupiter, including what turned out to be Ganymede, Callisto, and one body that turned out to be the combined light from Io and Europa. The next night he noticed that they had moved. On January 13th, he saw all four at once for the first time, but he had seen each of the moons before this date at least once. By January 15th, Galileo came to the conclusion that the stars were actually bodies orbiting Jupiter, thus the discovery of the moons. Galileo originally called Jupiter's moons the Medician planets, after the Medici family, and referred to the individual moons numerically as 1, 2, 3, and 4. Galileo's naming system would be used for a couple of centuries. It wouldn't be until the mid-1800s that the names of the Galilean moons, Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto, would be officially adopted, and only after it became apparent that naming moons by number would be very confusing as new additional moons were being discovered. In mythology, Ganymede was a beautiful young boy who was carried to Olympus by Zeus, the Greek equivalent of the Roman god Jupiter, disguised as an eagle. Ganymede became the cup-bearer of the Olympian gods. The Greek-Roman pantheons are the epicenter of many names of both planets and moons in our solar system. Number 7. Orbits and rotations. Ganymede orbits Jupiter at a distance of 1,070,400 kilometers, third among the Galilean satellites, and completes a revolution every 7 days and 3 hours, which indeed means that a day on Ganymede is a week here on Earth. That would be something that would take some getting used to, no doubt. Like most known moons, Ganymede is tidally locked, with one side always facing toward the planet. Hence, its day is 7 days and 3 hours. Its orbit is very slightly eccentric and inclined to the Jovian equator, with the eccentricity and inclination changing quasi-periodically due to solar and planetary gravitational perturbations on a timescale of centuries. Ganymede participates in orbital resonances with Europa and Io. For every orbit of Ganymede, Europa orbits twice and Io orbits 4 times. Conjunctions, alignment on the same side of Jupiter, between Io and Europa occur when Io is at periapsis and Europa at apopsis. Conjunctions between Europa and Ganymede occurred when Europa is at periapsis. The longitudes of the Io, Europa, and Europa-Ganymede conjunctions change with the same rate, making triple conjunctions impossible. Such a complicated resonance is called the Laplace resonance. There are two hypotheses for the origin of the Laplace resonance among Io, Europa, and Ganymede: that it is primordial and has existed from the beginning of the solar system, or that it developed after the formation of the solar system. A possible sequence of events for the latter scenario is as follows. Io raised tides on Jupiter, causing Io's orbit to expand, due to conservation of momentum, until it encountered the 2-to-1 resonance with Europa. After that, the expansion continued, but some of the angular momentum was transferred to Europa as the resonance caused its orbit to expand as well. The process continued until Europa encountered the 2-to-1 resonance with Ganymede. Eventually, the drift rates of conjunctions between all three moons were synchronized and locked in the Laplace resonance. Number 6. Composition. Ganymede has three main layers: a sphere of metallic iron at the center, the core, which generates a magnetic field, a spherical shell of rock, mantle, surrounding the core, and a spherical shell of mostly ice surrounding the rock shell and the core. The ice shell on the outside is very thick, maybe 800 kilometers or 497 miles thick. The surface is the very top of the ice shell. Though it is mostly ice, the ice shell might contain some rock mixed in. Scientists believe there must be a fair amount of rock in the ice near the surface. Ganymede's magnetic field is embedded inside Jupiter's massive magnetosphere. In 2004, scientists discovered irregular lumps beneath the icy surface of Ganymede. The irregular masses may be rock formations supported by Ganymede's icy shell for billions of years. This tells scientists that the ice is probably strong enough, at least near the surface, to support these possible rock masses from sinking to the bottom of the ice. However, this anomaly could also be caused by the piles of rock at the bottom of the ice. Spacecraft images of Ganymede show the moon has a complex geological history. Ganymede's surface is a mixture of two types of terrain. 40% of the surface of Ganymede is covered by highly cratered dark regions, and the remaining 60% is covered by a light grooved terrain, which forms intricate patterns across Ganymede. The term sulcus, meaning a groove or burrow, is often used to describe the groove features. This groove terrain is probably formed by tensional faulting or the release of water from beneath the surface. Groove ridges as high as 700 meters, 2,000 feet, have been observed, and the grooves run for thousands of kilometers across Ganymede's surface. The grooves have relatively few craters and probably developed at the expense of the darker crust. The dark regions on Ganymede are old and rough, and the dark cratered terrain is believed to be the original crust of the satellite. Lighter regions are young and smooth, unlike Earth's moon. The largest area on Ganymede is called Galileo region. The large craters on Ganymede have almost no vertical relief and are quite flat. They lack central depressions common to craters often seen on the rocky surface of the moon. This is probably due to slow and gradual adjustment to the soft, icy surface. These large phantom craters are called palimpsests, a term originally applied to reused ancient writing materials on which older writing was still visible underneath newer writing. Palimpsests range from 50 to 400 kilometers in diameter. Both bright and dark rays of ejecta exist around Ganymede's craters. Rays tend to be bright from craters in the grooved terrain and dark from the dark cratered terrain. Before we continue to deep dive into Ganymede and what's so interesting about it, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve our content for you, the viewer. Also, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Number 5. Size. Ganymede is the largest and most massive moon in the solar system. Its diameter of 5,268 kilometers is 0.41 times that of Earth, 0.77 times that of Mars, 1.02 times that of Saturn's Titan, the second largest moon, 1.08 times Mercury, 1.09 times Callisto, 1.45 times Io, and 1.51 times the Moon. Its mass is 10% greater than Titan's, 38% greater than Callisto's, 66% greater than Io's, and 2.02 times that of the Moon that orbits our own planet. This size has led to much research about the Moon, especially about its composition as we've documented, but it also opens up questions about habitation, as well as what might be under the surface. Number 4. The oceans below. In the 1970s, NASA scientists first suspected that Ganymede had a thick ocean between two layers of ice, one on the surface and one beneath a liquid ocean and atop the rocky mantle. In the 1990s, NASA's Galileo mission flew by Ganymede, confirming the moon's subsurface ocean. An analysis published in 2014, taking into account the realistic thermodynamics for water and effects of salt, suggests that Ganymede might have a stack of several ocean layers separated by different phases of ice, with the lowest liquid layer adjacent to the rocky mantle. Water-rock contact may be an important factor in the origin of life. The analysis also notes that the extreme depths involved, approximately 800 kilometers to the rocky sea floor, mean the temperatures at the bottom of a convective adiabatic ocean can be up to 40 Kelvin higher than those at the ice-water interface. In March 2015, scientists reported that measurements with the Hubble Space Telescope of how the aurora moved over Ganymede's surface suggest it has a subsurface ocean. A large saltwater ocean affects Ganymede's magnetic field, and consequently its aurora. The evidence suggests that Ganymede's oceans might be the largest in the entire solar system. There is some speculation on the potential habitability of Ganymede's ocean. Number 3. Life in the oceans. The prospect of life being in the oceans under the surface of Ganymede is intriguing and potentially life-altering in terms of how we view the solar system, mainly because at present the Earth is the only place in the solar system and the universe at large that has confirmed life on it. As a result, many astronomers and scientists have observed the moons, planets, and even stars for any traces of life in any form, even looking to other moons like Europa and Titan because they have potential for life in certain assets. But the question of whether they have the whole picture is a major question. In searching for worlds or even moons to live on, the question of water or even water vapor is brought up, because most agree that water is a key component to having life, as proven on Earth. So the proof that there are potential oceans of great size underneath Ganymede means that there is a chance that it could be there. If you think this is a stretch, then look back at Earth instead of near Jupiter, when life was formed. It started in the oceans and then made its way to land, not the other way around. So for all we know, there could be life in those oceans. But what kind of life? That's the mystery that still needs to be solved outside of the potential for it. It would be a stretch to say that it would be complex life, without a doubt, because we don't know the contents of the oceans and the various effects the planet itself has on the oceans. However, potentially microbial life is possible, as well as other simple forms of life. It's a question that's going to be asked for a while, and as such, many are going to debate whether it's possible or not. Number 2. Atmosphere. Believe it or not, there has been a lot of conflicting data and beliefs about what the atmosphere of Ganymede is. For example, in 1972, a team of astronomers believed they found proof of a thin atmosphere around the moon. But then when Voyager 1 came to the area and looked at the moon, it found very different results than them. Despite the Voyager data, evidence for a tenuous oxygen atmosphere, exosphere, on Ganymede, very similar to the one found on Europa, was found by the Hubble Space Telescope, HST, in 1995. Additional evidence of the oxygen atmosphere comes from spectral detection of gases trapped in the ice at the surface of Ganymede. The detection of ozone, O3 bands, was announced in 1996. In 1997, spectroscopic analysis revealed the dimmer or diatomic absorption features of molecular oxygen. Such an absorption can arise only if the oxygen is in a dense phase. The best candidate is molecular oxygen trapped in ice. Number 1. Formation. The formation of our solar system is something that is still debated to this day due to the varying beliefs on the Big Bang, the solar nebula theory, and more. Ganymede probably formed by an accretion in Jupiter's subnebula, a disk of gas and dust surrounding Jupiter after its formation. The accretion of Ganymede probably took about 10,000 years. Much shorter than the 100,000 years estimated for Callisto. The Jovian subnebula may have been relatively gas-starved when the Galilean satellites formed. This would have allowed for the lengthy accretion times required for Callisto. In contrast, Ganymede formed closer to Jupiter, where the subnebula was denser, which explains its shorter formation timescale. This relatively fast formation prevented the escape of accretional heat, which may have led to ice melt and differentiation, the separation of rocks and ice. The rocks settled to the center, forming the core. In this respect, Ganymede is different from Callisto, which apparently failed to melt and differentiate early due to loss of the accretional heat during its slower formation. This hypothesis explains why the two Jovian moons look so dissimilar, despite their similar mass and composition. Alternative theories explain Ganymede's greater internal heating on the basis of tidal flexing or more intense pummeling by impactors during the late heavy bombardment. In the latter case, modeling suggests that differentiation would become a runaway process at Ganymede, but not Callisto. After formation, Ganymede's core largely retained the heat accumulated during accretion and differentiation, only slowly releasing it to the ice mantle. The mantle in turn transported it to the surface by convection. The decay of radioactive elements within rocks further heated the core, causing increased differentiation, an inner iron-iron sulfide core, and a silicate mantle formed. With this, Ganymede became a truly differentiated body. Today, Ganymede continues to cool slowly. The heat being released from its core and silicate mantle enables the subsurface ocean to exist, whereas the slow cooling of the liquid iron sulfide core causes convection and supports magnetic field generation. Thanks for watching. What did you think of this look at Ganymede and the history and facts about it? Did you learn something special about the moon and why it might be incredibly special? What do you think humanity will learn about the moon next? Let us know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.